Session 3 discusses the management of the first stage of labor. Remember that in our earlier sessions, I said that to understand or appreciate this topic, it is important to have your knowledge on the physiology at the tip of your finger so that you appreciate and understand what happens during the management of the stage, especially when we come to the second stage. You should be able to apply your knowledge on the physiology of the second stage to be able to manage the second stage effectively. Session 3 will focus on the management of the first stage of labor. Topics such as respectful maternity care, pain relief, emotional support, nutrition and hydration, bowel and bladder care, and positions used in labor will be discussed. Other observations and procedures like maternal vital signs, vaginal examination, etc. will be carried out during the practical sessions. By the end of the session, I expect that students will be able to describe the observations to be made on the woman during the first stage of labor, outline the pharmacological and non-pharmacological methods of pain relief, provide appropriate care to the woman, provide nutrition, safety, elimination, etc. Our session outline, these are the various topics: immediate care, subsequent care, care during the latent phase, care during the active phase, and care during the transitional phase of the first stage of labor. That's the reading list. Immediate care. In managing the first stage of labor, immediate care, we are talking about admitting the woman, establishing rapport, taking a very good history of labor, and examining the woman's antenatal card to find out the progress she's been making so far during pregnancy, and if there are any instructions being given by the obstetrician. Immediate care. We're talking about the history of labor. We want to find out when did the labor start, whether or not membranes have ruptured, what and when was the last meal. These are all very important, because if the woman had just eaten and there is a need for intervention, we may have to pass a nasogastric tube and empty the stomach contents. We may also have to give some antacids to prevent aspiration of the stomach contents. You carry out general examination from head to toe on this woman. You ask her to empty the bladder, test urine for protein and sugar, and then you check the blood sugar, pulse, and the respiration. Still on the immediate care, we carry out a vaginal examination to confirm labor. Is she even having any cervical dilatations? Has the membranes ruptured? If they have ruptured, what was the color of the membranes? Did it have any odor? What was the color of the lyco? If this lyco is smelling, it means infection has set in and there will be the need to intervene before you proceed. Then dilatation of the cervix. You know the condition of the cervix, whether soft and well applied to the presenting part. Condition of vagina, is it moist or hot? And then record findings on a labor chart or pathograph if client is an active stage of labor. Communicate findings to clients and relatives, and you admit woman based on your findings. Subsequent care. In subsequent care, we want to look at infection prevention. We use standard precautions throughout procedures and labor and observe all infection prevention measures. Personal hygiene is ensured. You educate her on changing her perineal pad as soon as swelled. This is very important because we don't want the pad to stay for long. If the place becomes very moist, it encourages microbial growth. And then bladder care. The woman will have to empty the bladder all the time, or you provide the woman with a bedpan. If she cannot urinate, then there may be the need to pass a urethral catheter. You have to test the urine thoroughly for protein and sugar. Rest is also important. Encourage her to assume any position suitable to her, and then restrict movement if the membranes have ruptured to prevent prolapse of the cord. So if the woman has intact membranes and the presenting part is well fitting, then she can be walking up and down so that some gravity will be applied and it will aid descent. But once the membranes rupture and the head is not well applied, if she walks about, the cord will slip and come in front of the presenting part, and then fetal distress will occur. Give the woman some diversional therapy to take her mind off the pain. She can be watching television or reading, or you engage her in conversation so she doesn't focus so much on her pain. Engage her in any activity, TV, rubbing of her sacral region, and deep breathing exercises. Nutrition. If labor is progressing normally, then she can go on a light nourishing diet. If the labor is not well established and it's not progressing well, then this woman will have to take nothing by mouth, or what we refer to as nil per os. You observe the facility's protocol. In some facilities, once the woman enters into labor, there is no feeding through the mouth, so she goes on IV infusion. Remember that we shouldn't allow this woman to become dehydrated or exhausted. If she's not taking anything by mouth, then we may have to set up an IV infusion to provide nutrition for the woman. Now, medications. We can get pain relieving medications like Pethidine, and it is given intramuscularly, and it is given anytime before 6 cm dilatation. And then it can, promethazine or Finagen could be added, because Pethidine induces vomiting, and promethazine is an anti-emetic, and it will help to offset the effects of the Pethidine. It usually wears off within 2 to 4 hours, and it has a sedative effect on both mother and the baby. Vaginal examination is done every 4 hours. Ideally, the cervix should dilate 1 cm per an hour in the active phase. During vaginal examination, you note and record the color of lichen, molding, and the descent. Check contraction every 30 minutes. You listen to the fetal heart rate every 30 minutes. You monitor the first stage using the pathograph. There is a whole session on the pathograph, and when we get there, we'll be looking at the symbols we use to plot the graph and how to record all the things we have mentioned in this session. Care during the latent phase of the first stage. The duration of the latent phase is usually 6 hours. Cervical dilatation is about 3 to 4 centimeters. Uterine contractions occur every 15 to 30 minutes, and they're of short duration and mild intensity. The woman's attitude is excited with some degree of apprehension. During the latent phase, you give support measures, you establish rapport, you support the woman in breathing exercises, you encourage ambulation if the membranes are intact, and then you offer ice cubes or fluids to the woman. You encourage client to void or urinate to prevent a full bladder, which will cause delayed or prolonged labor. Care during the active phase. Active phase, cervical dilatation is 4 to 8 centimeters. Uterine contractions occur 3 to 5 minutes, 30 to 60 seconds duration, and then of moderate intensity. The woman's attitude, she becomes afraid, and she feels as if she's losing control of herself. Support measures in the active phase. You encourage breathing exercise. You provide a quiet environment. Provide reassurance. Tell her that it will be over soon. You are doing very well. And give her all the support. Provide some comfort to this woman. If you give her back massage, you assist her to change her position. You support her with pillows. They are all forms or various ways by which you can provide comfort to this woman. You also provide ice chips for the dry mouth. And care during the transitional phase. During this phase, the dilatation is about 8 to 10 centimeters, and there are changes in the mood and intensity of contractions. The contractions become very strong, and now they become expulsive. The membranes may rupture at this stage, and if the membranes have not ruptured and there is full dilatation of the cervix, then we may do what we call artificial rupture of the membranes. If the show has not also come, the show also have to leave at this time, and there is uncontrollable urge to push during contractions. Nursing management is still about breathing technique, control chest or coastal breathing during contractions, avoidance of bearing down. At this stage, though the cervix may be fully dilated, we have to rule out the prince of the anterior lip of the cervix, which is always the last to thin out before we allow the woman to push. But remember, we have said that now the contractions are overwhelming and explosive, and there is the urge for this woman to push. So you tell her to breathe through the mouth as the urge comes and relax and avoid bearing down. You provide every emotional support, praising her. You give her comfort measures, and you call the obstetrician's attention if necessary. In summary, we have said that the first stage of labor consists of three phases: the latent, the active, and the transitional phase. Each phase differs from the other by the difference in the intensity of the contractions. And the transition phase is the shortest yet the most intense phase of the three phases. So from the transition phase, we are moving to the second stage of labor. These are the references.